Visiting with Huell Howser is made possible through a generous grant from the Ralph M. Parsons Foundation.
Well, hello, everybody. I'm Huell Howser. Get ready for a learning experience. And in order to do that, we're going to recreate history. Here's the setup. A couple of months ago, I was walking down Larchmont Boulevard with my morning coffee. This is in my neighborhood. And I got to this point on the boulevard, right in front of this bench. And here was this guy sitting over on the bench. And now the recreation takes place, Nathan.
Huell.
That's exactly what he did, and I think I said something like, "Who are you? Do I owe you money or what?"
Who are you? That's what he said.
Well, it turned out the reason he jumped up was that the day before he had been doing a bad imitation of me to some of your friends, right?
In Silver Lake Dog Park, yeah.
All right, and so we end up meeting on Larchmont Boulevard. We start talking. I find out that Nathan is from Kentucky. Well, I'm originally from Tennessee, so we started talking about Kentucky and Tennessee, and then I got around to asking you why you were in L.A. You were in L.A. to make a film, and then it really got interesting. What was the film about that you wanted to make?
The film was about epilepsy.
And why did you want to make a film about epilepsy?
Because I have epilepsy. And I wanted other people to understand what it was like to have a seizure.
See, now that's really what got me hooked, because I am convinced, I know I don't, and I don't think many of our viewers, I don't think many people know very much about epilepsy, do they?
They don't. That's true. A lot of people think there's a lot of myths surrounding epilepsy, and they're afraid when someone's having a seizure. They don't know what to do. They think it's very violent, it's very intense. And so to alleviate the worry, I thought a point of view film would be necessary to alleviate that.
So you made a point of view film from the point of view of yourself having an epileptic fit.
That's correct.
That's what scares people so much, is we get scared that if we're around someone who has an epileptic fit, they're down on the ground and they're moving around and they're kind of uncontrollable, and it scares most people, don't you think?
It does. And the first time I saw a seizure, I was scared. I didn't know what to do, so I hesitated and I didn't react and actually help that person.
Yeah.
And that's where the danger comes into play. So making and recreating this experience for other people to see what goes on in my head, what I see, what I hear, would help educate them to actually be able to know what's going on, proper first aid.
All right, let's walk down here, because these three people, come on up here. They're not here by accident. This is Nathan. Well, this is the director of the film right here. Your name is?
Charles.
Okay, and you are Nathan's roommate.
Yes. Andy Miller.
You had a role in the film.
That's right.
So did you get paid anything
for
this?
No, okay. I didn't.
Well, that's okay.
That's all right.
And you're the girlfriend.
Yeah.
I know you didn't get paid anything.
No,
certainly not. You're his manager, his agent, his hairstylist, his makeup person.
Yeah.
You generally take care of this poor guy.
Exactly, yeah.
Come on in here, Nathan, because this is what's interesting. This is the film that Nathan and the assembled cast and crew and extended family made together. We're going to look at it right now, and I don't know whether we should warn people, but we should let people know that it is an intense film, isn't it? It grabs you.
It is what it is. It's a seizure. It's a 7-minute recreation. And I hope it can be a learning experience for everybody at home watching right now.
Well, now this is just the beginning of the learning experience. We're going to watch this 7-minute film right now. And then we'll be back to continue our education about epilepsy. Here is Nathan's film right now.
We're at El Prado Park in You just have to let him rip.
Can you hear me? Doing good, okay? How long is this going on for? 10 minutes?
Yeah, okay. We're on 12 right now.
Just relax,
okay? We're here for you, alright? Okay, relax, alright, bud?
Just relax.
Take it easy, okay?
We're here to help you. Calm down.
Just take it easy, okay, bud? Just relax, okay? There you go, okay?
Calm down.
Alright, there you go, okay, Nate? There you go, okay? Stay right here, okay, bud? We're right here with you, okay? Just relax.
Just relax. We're here to help you, alright?
Let me get respirations on him.
You'll be alright, okay?
Stay calm, okay? We're here to help, alright? Just relax for us, okay? You just had a seizure, alright, Nate? We're gonna get some oxygen on you, alright, bud?
Gotta go in at 15 liters?
Yep. Hey, Nate, I'm gonna get some oxygen on you, okay, bud? It's gonna help you breathe a little bit. Just like that. Just relax, okay? Alright. Ready to go?
Yeah.
Okay, on you.
Ready?
Yep.
1, 2.
It's alright, dude? It's okay, man.
We're gonna get you in the ambulance, okay, man?
Almost over, man.
A little pump, right? We're going off the curve.
It's alright, man. It's okay.
You right there?
Yeah.
Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Joe, you ride with us.
Someone grab my shoes.
Maybe also two? Okay, Nate? All right, everything looks good, all right? You're doing a good job. Just relax, okay? Eyes right here, okay? I'm right here with you. Doing good, Nate. Just relax. What's that, Nate?
This is spaghetti on my arms.
It's not spaghetti.
Just take it easy. I'm gonna put this mask back on you, okay? Calm down, Nate. Just relax, bud, okay? Just relax. Just relax, Nate. Relax,
come on,
Nate.
Come on,
Nate. Just calm down,
Nate. Stay down, bud. Come on.
Calm down,
it's okay.
Nate, just relax.
Nate,
just relax.
Focus.
Relax.
Look at me. Stay down.
Relax, Nate.
Stay down.
Just relax.
It's okay.
Just relax, Nate. Nate, relax. Take it easy, okay? We're here to help you, alright? Hold that arm to make sure that IV doesn't come out. Just relax, buddy, okay? Just relax. Take it easy, okay? Take it easy. Look at me. Look at me right now. Take it easy. Calm down, okay? We're here to help you. Calm down. Just relax, buddy. Just relax, okay? Calm down. Calm down, Nate. Calm down. Just relax, Nate. Just relax, okay? Just relax. Look at me. Calm down. I'm here to help you, okay? Just relax, bud. Just relax.
It's okay, man.
Come on. Stay with us. Here, we're going to pull something.
Just relax, all right, bud?
Stay down. Stay down.
Just relax.
Huh?
What's that, Nate?
This is spaghetti out of my arms.
Nate, everything's all right, okay? It's in there for a reason. It needs to stay in there, all right, bud? Just going to go in and keep it in there, okay? I'm going to get this mask back on you.
first. Okay. Oh, that's good. Yeah. Listen, are you okay? Can you hear me? Nathan, are you okay? Nathan?
Well, we're back, and I sure hope you enjoyed Nathan's film. I told you it was going to be very intense, and it was, but it had a happy ending.
It did. I woke up conscious, in control, ready to move on.
All right, ready to move on. We have moved on. We have left Larchmont Boulevard, and we have come across town to...
the USC Health Sciences Center.
Okay, your name is?
I am Dr. Christy Heck.
Okay, now Nathan brought us here because he said, you know what you're talking about,
which is
epilepsy.
That's right.
I contend that most people watching don't know anything about epilepsy.
And I think you're right.
What is epilepsy?
Epilepsy is an electrical storm of the brain that comes intermittently and for many, many reasons. It's a broad spectrum of underlying etiologies, underlying reasons for
an
people.
An electrical storm.
An electrical storm, yes.
Does it feel like an electrical storm?
It feels like what you just saw.
Wow.
It
is intense.
Originates from different parts of the brain, so some of those parts will shut off. I won't be able to see for a certain amount of time. I won't be able to hear. I might actually hear the high ringing, like the tinnitus you heard in the ambulance. You wake up out of control of your central nervous system.
Now, how many people have epilepsy? This is an old... epilepsy goes way back, doesn't it?
It goes way back into the dark ages, absolutely.
And what percentage of people have it?
Well, we aren't really sure, but we could probably estimate at least 3 million people in this country alone
have epilepsy. Of different sorts, because there are different types of epilepsy, some more intense than others, some that can be controlled by drugs, some that can't be. I mean, it really covers the whole spectrum.
Absolutely. And there are all sorts of reasons for people to develop epilepsy.
Is it something you're born with, or does it develop over your lifespan?
Well, there are some familial types of epilepsy. Certain families that tend to have many members who have epilepsy.
So it can be passed on.
It can be, but that's probably more rare. There are lots of other reasons. People have brain tumors, vascular malformations, strokes, or simply it occurs out of the blue, what we call idiopathically, which means we have no reason.
All right, let's find out. We've got a young lady who has epilepsy, who is, you brought her here because she comes to this center. Your name is?
Emily Evans.
Okay, now, and this is your mom. Your name is?
Kristen Evans.
Was your daughter born with epilepsy, or is this something that developed?
Yeah, it was seen by her second grade teacher.
Did you actually have a seizure in the classroom?
I have the kind of seizures where I stare. They're called petite mal seizures. And my teacher in second grade noticed them. Because
did you know you were having a seizure?
Well, I didn't know what epilepsy was, but I did notice that if I would get called on in class, I wouldn't react. And then people would be poking me like, Emily, your teacher called on you.
And you didn't know why they were poking you. You didn't even know your teacher had been calling on you.
No.
Well, this must have mystified you and caused all kinds of concern as her mom.
It did. It did. And as a parent, I spent a year thinking she was like spacing out, not listening, maybe going through some weird growth spurt. I did not know because I had no education prior to anything about epilepsy. And it was really getting called into her teacher's office saying, I think there might be something that Emily needs to get tested for, which would be petit mal. They used to call it. Now it can be called absence seizures as
well. Is this the normal? This is normal for people to find out they have epilepsy who don't even know what epilepsy is.
Absolutely. Many people will go for months, years without a diagnosis. And it really, and sometimes even their general physicians will be mystified by an odd complaint that persist.
Wow. Well, when you found out what it was, how did you react?
You're
probably relieved in a way to at least know what it was.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And getting referred to our first neurologist, pediatric neurologist, where we went and we could get the diagnosis for sure, begin medication, which really took away the seizures immediately.
So this must have been wonderful for you in a way to find out what was wrong too.
Yeah, it was nice to know what was wrong, but then again, I was at such a young age where it was kind of just like, okay.
Yeah.
You know, I don't really know what's up because I'm at such a young age where I can't really understand it, but if you're telling me this, then cool.
Wow, and this started this whole journey that you've had, which is kind of a continuing journey, but a journey that has positive chapters in it. It's not negative like it used to be.
It's not negative in that we know, and there was a long period of time in grade school where the medication they had her on worked really well, and it kept the seizures at bay. And then after about 2 years ago, when she was 15, she had an adverse reaction
to
the medication.
The medication is constantly changing, isn't it?
That's right. And we are constantly looking for new solutions.
Are you on medication now?
I am. I take Depakote, 1,000 milligrams a day, every day.
Now, what would happen if you didn't take it?
If I didn't take it, that would lower what's called a seizure threshold. Everyone in this room, including you, can have a seizure under the right conditions.
Mm-hmm. And so everybody out there is capable of having a seizure.
Everybody, under the right conditions, if your brain is stressed, if your body is stressed, you are liable to have a seizure. And what medication does for someone who has had a seizure is it brings their seizure threshold back up to what you would call a normal, whatever that means.
So most people with epilepsy are under some sort of medication.
Most people with epilepsy
or treatment or
they require medication for the most part.
You wheel this machine in. I have no idea what it is. They understood immediately what it was. You've used this machine before, haven't you?
Yes.
What's it called?
It's an EEG machine.
An EEG machine. You've had one too. We've got some photographs of you because you wanted to take pictures while you were having it done.
Yeah, I wanted to document it. It was cool. They hook these up to your brain.
What? These?
These are electrodes. And they record the electrical activity of your brain.
And what does that do? What difference does it make that you know what the electrical...
Well, there are certain electrical patterns that we look for to help us diagnose epilepsy and the different types of epilepsy. And so the patterns that we see will be signatures for either a place in the brain where the seizures are arising from or a general type of epilepsy.
And helps you know how to treat that type
That's
of epilepsy.
Correct.
And you have undergone some treatment, which is fascinating. You had surgery to do what? It wasn't a surgery on your brain.
No.
It was surgery on your neck.
Yeah. Well, because the medication, first of all, the first medication wasn't working out, so we tried a different medication, but that didn't work out so well either. So they had this implanted, which is called the VNS, the vagus nerve stimulator. And what it is it's like a little pacemaker that has a wire that connects to the vagal nerve, and it basically stimulates my brain to help me not have seizures.
Wow. And I said this was just a simple procedure, and you said what?
She was out of our sight for 5 hours. So
in the operating room.
Between
so it's very
recovery
the way
and
they put it
everything.
In.
Yeah, it took some time. We had to, Dr. Heck referred us to the surgeons next door, and we went over and met with them and then went in for surgery early in the morning.
Wow.
And she had to stay overnight, and it was pretty major.
See, this is something, if we had been talking about epilepsy 10 or 20 years ago, we wouldn't have heard that story, would we?
No, we wouldn't have.
So there are advances being made all the time.
Always, yes. Tons of advances, especially in technology.
And in the kinds of, I mean, to think of implanting something like
that's
that.
That's right, that's right.
Did you have to have that?
I didn't. Surgery was put on the table. At that point, I changed physicians, and I was actually went to the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. So I'm a lucky few, Huell, that is controlled with medication, and I get to enjoy independences that others don't with epilepsy. And in that newfound independence, I'm happy to complete the film.
Yeah.
Get it done and help educate others about epilepsy.
Have you had, how long has it been since you've, is it called a seizure?
Yeah, seizure.
How long has it been since you've had a seizure?
It's been 6 years.
Really?
Yeah.
What about you? Any kind of reaction?
I've had several today.
You're today?
Yeah. I usually have them every day.
But I didn't see anything.
Yeah. Usually people don't even notice. Mm-hmm. I have them and I just stare, and they only last 2 to 5 seconds, and the only way you would actually be able to notice is if I were speaking.
That is, I'm shocked.
Yeah, she has absence epilepsy, and it's simply brief staring episodes where her electrical activity of her brain synchronizes into a brief storm.
See, I'm thinking of epilepsy as the traditional, you fall on the ground, you're moving around, you have to give somebody something to bite on. I mean, this is old time wives' tale about epilepsy.
No, those are wise tales. You don't hold their tongue, you don't do that. Someone has a seizure, they fall on the ground, it's important to protect them. That's it.
Against themselves, really. I mean, they don't know what's happening.
Protect them. Right. It's such a wide spectrum. It's so hard to address it like a fire issue, like stop, drop, and roll. She blanks out for a period of time. She may or may not fall over. Other people, as you saw in the film, get extremely combative when they black out and wake up to people holding them down. I mean,
yeah.
How would you react if you blacked out and you're surrounded by 4 people yelling, Huell,
I know.
Huell, what
I
are
know.
You doing? You know,
this
so
is, this whole thing opens up this whole idea I have that people watching just don't know. We don't know what epilepsy is. We don't know how it's treated. We don't know what to do if we come into contact with someone having a seizure, whether it's a big seizure. Her teacher didn't even know it was epilepsy. She thought maybe she was just not being responsive in class, right?
She had had some training in it, which I was grateful for. The teacher had had training, and she saw the signs.
Well, you're lucky, because
absolutely.
The teacher might not have had. All these people go totally undiagnosed.
That's right, and they go undiagnosed for a very long time.
There may be more people with epilepsy than we even know of.
You're right.
But there are centers like this that doctors bring patients to of all ages, mm-hmm. and you find out basically what kind of treatment they should have to correct. I mean, every single person really is actually on an individual basis as far as what can be done for them.
Yeah, every patient is completely unique. What kind of epilepsy they have is completely unique to their situation, so it's treated as such.
Wow. Well, should we be optimistic?
Absolutely. You know, one of my main charges in my career is to keep hope, to make sure people know that if their epilepsy is not controlled now, someday it will be, and we will find answers.
Because this is something they both will live with the rest of their lives. But it doesn't have to be a negative thing. It's just a fact of life that's an inconvenience from time to time, but it doesn't affect their quality of life.
Well, it does affect quality of life for many, many people, and that's what a center like this offers, is the a concept that we can consider as specialists how epilepsy affects patients, not only with respect to having seizures and controlling seizures, but having side effects from their treatments, all of the isolation that epilepsy, uncontrolled epilepsy, instills in people.
The social isolation.
Social isolation, inability as an adult to drive to work because you can't get to your work.
Wow.
The depression, there are a lot of what we call comorbidities that come along with epilepsy because people find themselves alone. And even though it is a very widespread disorder and very, very common, you don't feel that way as a patient when you have it, because you can be walking down the street looking completely normal one moment, and then you're struck down and you live with that fear.
Do you feel comfortable talking about it, or is something you'd just rather just not be a part of, you know, the conversation?
As a kid, like younger, I didn't used to want to talk about it because, you know, I felt different from everybody, like there was something wrong with me. But, you know, as I've come to realize that it's something that's just, you know, it's something not to be ashamed of, I'm more comfortable with it and I'm more open with telling people.
Yeah. And do people understand, or are they like I am, they're learning about it, they don't know what you're talking
about?
Yeah,
I usually have to explain to people about it because, you know, not a lot of people know about it, obviously. It's not like one of the major disabilities, I guess you would call it.
Right.
But, you know, once I explain it, then people are just like, okay, cool.
I wouldn't be surprised at all if Emily's teacher actually learned about epilepsy from one of our presentations.
So is this, are you mainly interested in medical advances or in getting the word out among the general population as to what epilepsy is, or both?
If we're going to end epilepsy, we need people like Nathan who are going to speak up about it.
Or this young lady right here.
And absolutely, like Emily, who is willing to tell her friends about epilepsy. We need people who are going to pursue seizure control through medication, through dietary therapies, through surgical treatment for new advances like centers like here at USC. It's many diseases. It's many types of epilepsy. Epilepsy is a big deal disease. It is the most common serious neurological disorder in the world. 1 in 3 adults know someone with epilepsy, but no one knows anything about it.
Yeah.
And your show will help educate people about epilepsy.
Get the idea. It's a family, an extended family, and now it's a family that involves all of us, because knowledge is power. Yes. And now we've all hopefully learned a little bit more about epilepsy. This has been an absolutely slam dunk learning experience for us all.
Visiting with Huell Howser is made possible through a generous grant from the Ralph M. Parsons Foundation.